A very good afternoon to one and all present. I, Shubhada Jaggare, on behalf of PES, Modern College of Pharmacy, Nigdi, welcomes you all to a short-term training program sponsored by AICTE on innovations in effective teaching, learning pedagogy, and research skill development. I welcome our honorable guest, Dr. M.S. Ganachari, sir. He will be delivering a lecture on blending the technologies for qualitative learning through flipped classroom. Sir has successfully completed M.Pharm from Karnataka University in 1992, followed by PhD at KLE University in 2011. Presently, he is serving as a Dean Faculty of Pharmaceutical Science and Head of Department of Pharmacy Practice and Deputy Registrar at KLE University, Belgaum. Sir is Member Secretary at KLE University, Clinical Pharmacist for Phase 3 Clinical Trial USA, Reviewer for American Journal of Health System, President of Indian Pharmaceutical Association at Belgaum. Sir is also a life member of APTI, IPA, IPS, APPI, and IPHA. He also received Best Teacher Award in 2010 by KLE University and Best Paper Published in Indian Journal of Pharmacy Practice in 2011 by APTI. Sir has 28 years of teaching experience and guided more than 63 M.Pharm and 7 PhD students. I kindly request you, sir, to deliver a session. You are a host now.
Good afternoon. Hope my audio and videos are clear.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank and the organizers making the slight change in the schedule. And my apology for this change in the schedule because of some of my official commitment. My special thanks goes to Dr. P.D. Chaudhary Saab and his colleagues, specifically all the time they were behind Chopde Saab and all those people. I'm really thankful, sir, for showing so much kind towards me and making this day happen possible. Fine, the title, the topic what I'm going to deal with is today is that the blending the technologies for qualitative learning through one of the concept what we call it is a flipped classroom. Friends, I know that we have got more than 60 or 70 the participants are here, and we are all undergone the serious pandemic sessions and during pandemic. Even right now in Maharashtra, still there is a grim situation is there. During the situations, I'm sure that all the teachers were doing online classes, being in touch with the students and try to train them, try to teach them and so on and so forth. In such a scenario, this is very, very important to understand how to blend the technologies for qualitative learning or for the qualitative teaching. Are there any technologies? Are there methods? Probably earlier, one of my speaker would have told how to adopt it and how to you take use of this flipped classroom in the morning. But what I'm going to do is now, we are going to understand to whom are we teaching? What are the population we are addressing the classes? Or what are the nature of the students? Generally, we call them as millennials. So next couple of slides, I'll try to understand or try to go through that. What are the population we are addressing or who are the students and what are their qualitative characteristics of the people who are addressing the, or we are teaching them and how it will be win-win for the teachers taking over this pandemic situations and making a teaching a more effective one. As I said, nowadays what we call it is the online classes were very much followed by the students, and that's what we are doing today. I'm joining as a virtual here and trying to talk to the many of the colleagues across the state or across the countries. But nevertheless, when you talk about seniors and some of us like saying that yaar, kya chal raha hai? Is it so effective? How to make it effective? Always we have got a sense of a pleasure, right? When you start talking to the face-to-face. Now I'm talking to a screen. We don't know the facial expression of the audience. We don't know, because teaching is an art. by seeing the students' face and all those things, we can modulate our lectures. If they're bored, we can make it more lively. If they're enthusiastic, we can give more and more example. But keeping all these concerns, but the target, our challenge is to have certain use of certain technologies. For that reasons is what I thought and what we thought it will talk something about the flip classroom for the millennials. Now let us try to understand what are these millennials. And why I am stressing more and more about this millennial concept. In Carlson in 2005 only wrote it, a new generation of students have arrived and they say, sorry, that they might not want to hear you lecture for an hour. Before pandemic, all teachers will agree with me saying that, you know, the less attendances are there in the class, students are not coming to the class. Even if they sit in the class, they are not proactive and so on and so forth. Even before pandemic also, we had challenges. For simple reason, because they don't have the patience to listen. So who are our students? Our students are baby boomers, right? Are they baby boomers? No. Baby boomers are called as who are born between 1946 to 64, probably much senior than me, where all these populations grew up in the time of economic expansion, prosperity, major social movements, and national optimism. So what are the core values of our teachers? I can call my teachers as their core values is to include optimism, team orientation, the personal gratification, very important in those days was health and wellness, personal growth, work and involvement. But subsequently, then came the Generation X. So those who are born between 65 to 77, probably I may belong to this Generation X categories, where this Generation X population witnessed corporate layoff, corruption, inflation, the energy crisis, nuclear proliferation, and so on and so forth. Having the values including diversities, thinking globally, balancing, very important our batch was a techno-literacy. All the entire this Generation X were behind their technical understanding, techno-literacies. Apart from those things, informality, self-reliances, and pragmatism were the characteristics of the people who belong to Generation X. Then subsequently, there came the Generation Y, who born between 1977 through 2000 until date, where they grew up between the defined between the 9/11 bombing of Oklahoma City, school shooting, and they're all raised in a child-focused environment when you look for the U.S. Scenarios were there. But so what are the characteristics of this thing? Their value, where main values of this Generation Y students were including optimism, they looked for civic duties, confidence, achievement, sociability, morality. They were really street smarts and they were all diversity. So these are different generations what we have gone through, right from my teachers, myself, my junior teachers, and so on and so forth. Next is the Generation Z. The Generation Z are generally called as a millennials, where they're born to 1990s till present, where they all grew up with internet, cell phone, iPad, iPods. They get all information fast and expect it quickly. They often are seen as an impatient and technically savvy. But what are their values? Values are sense of social justice, philanthropy, maturity that comes with the growing up in an economically depressed time. We all agree, as I said, our challenge before pandemic was there, how to hold back the students in the classes, how to make them sit patiently, how to make them listen. So during that time also, this concept blending of this technology was very much relevant, very much useful for us to understand that how to make these millennials to make an effective learning, not because of the pandemic, or post-pandemic, even a pre-pandemic, we had challenges. The simple reason is that the technology was not a barrier for them. If you remember, and the teachers of my age, if they are there in the group now, I don't know how many of you they are there in the group. They all agree saying that we never had mobile phones, and even there were no color TVs and so on and so forth. That is not with the millennials. Millennials have never lived without technology, but many young teachers find themselves working in colleges where they're stuck with past. I can't say to my students, you know, I don't know about mobile, I don't know about technology, Right. I can't say that, you know, by good old days we were there where I used to use the blackboard or the chalk piece and all those things. But we can't do all those things. All the millennials are grow up around computers. So it is easier for them to adopt constantly changing technologies. And apart from those things, you can understand this, millennials are very brainiest. They're best educated generation ever, according to a special report compiled by The Economist. We should agree that when we were there in this age, we don't know how much smart we were there, or at least I was there. But the millennials are more smart. They're multitasking. They know many of the things is through the different social medias and all those things. And also, they stand out because they are most diverse and educated generation today. Depending upon the interest, you can ask the students if they're interested in cars, you know, they can tell 101 qualities of the cars. If they're good in technology, they can speak in technology because everything is available at their fingertips. If I'm teaching pharmacology is more and more interactive through many of the video casts and all those things. Then the challenge is there, why they should come to my class? Can we make it more and more interesting? Can we make it more and more amicable to understand for the students to accept the things what they want? So this is the whole idea, saying that right from generation X, Y, Z, millennials. So as a teacher, we should have to adopt the technologies, use the technologies, and you are going to make it more and more relevant. And the students are there, the millennials are there. We can call them, they were born the day before yesterday. Or so it may seem. If you remember, millions have no memory of world without a World Wide Web. They don't have anything to remember by other than www. Without cell phones, they can't sleep. Or with the personal computers. There's so much prolific in internet surfing, iPodding, texting, Googling, Facebooking. I'm a generation so and so forth. So many things are there, very much well versed. But we should not take it as a disadvantage. We should take it as an advantage. We all agree that before pandemic, we used to see the big banners in the classrooms and everywhere, cell phones are banned. You can't use the phones. What has happened now? Things have changed. We expect the students should have a smartphone. We expect students should have the phone. We expect students should have the good connectivity, good internet, because the change, things have been changed. So that could be the positive side of the pandemic. We can look for that, taking this advantage of using those things. And it becomes icing on the cream for the generation of the students whom are we teaching. And if you look for that, many of the students, that texting and instant messaging have become the chosen methods of communication. Perhaps most of all, they have been plugged into one or other electronic device since they were toddlers. And these are our students, and we need to explore the ways of adopting the college classrooms to reach them and to teach them more effectively. And we all agree that we have got different hundreds and hundreds of WhatsApp groups are there. We keep on texting. I do agree, somewhere we are missing certain human touch. A simple anecdote or simple classical example I would like to share. Suppose if I put a text in the group saying that, you know, happy birthday, Chopra Sir. Next 2 minutes, hundreds and thousands of the emojis, the flowers, cakes, everything will dump into the WhatsApp group. But if you happen to meet Chopra Sir with a person, we even forget to wish him personally. Probably that may be the human touch where we are losing it, we may be missing it, but nothing the less, we should have to accept and keep on moving. The next is, the challenge for teaching these millennials effectively doesn't mean we need to be a friend to them on Facebook. We never mean that. Or to start a thread with on Twitter, although that may be an effective way of keeping touch with them. But it doesn't mean that we need to reevaluate how we reach them and teach them both inside and outside the classrooms. Traditional lectures mode of instruction may not be dead, but it requires retooling in this age of limited attention spans and increased emphasis on the student engagement. When you say the limited attention of the spans, we know that for high school, the classes will be 45 minutes. For colleges, it will be 60 minutes. I don't know about guest lecture, how much Chaudhary Saab has given time to me. It looks like 1 hour. But we never assess the attention span of the audience. We never assess the attention span of the participants. But the traditional lecture continues, but we should have to retooling it, revisiting it, use technology, adopt new technology, and make it more and more effective. That's what whole today's session was there on this, how to blend the technology for effective teaching. So, one of the bold statements I would like to make, no less use any technology to enhance good teaching, but there'll be no replacement for good teachers. Then you can't ask me, or you should not have a doubt, sir. Sir, itna pura karne ke baad, then why, what is the role of a teacher? Past, historically, nobody has replaced teacher. Future also, nobody is going to replace the teachers. When the technology came into picture, that newspaper people or press media, the printing media were in big dilemma. If everything is going to come on TV and all the radios and all those things, who are going to read our papers? How many of you agree that papers are dead? I don't think so. I start a day, even I've heard 100 times in the news and different channels, my social media, internet, Google, but nevertheless, I start the day with reading a newspaper, the cup of a tea. What does it mean? Certain things cannot be replaced at any conditions. Hence, use of technology is to enhance good teaching, but not replacing the good technology, good teaching. There may be many established and emerging instruction technology that can be used effectively, could be using PowerPoint, the course management, including management systems, using many of the technologies are there where we can use it for the teaching, for the technology, where to enhance the good teaching, and we are not going to replace for the good teaching. So as to do this, what we should do is that develop a collaborative courses, assignments. Here, many millennials have been working in groups in schools. So one of the examples of collaborative learning exercise aimed at millennials used to have the creation of the group or class wiki or the WhatsApp, etc. I'm sure during the pandemic and even now also, I'm sure all teachers have got the class groups, their teachers have got the teacher group, class teacher groups, mentor groups, and now it has become an official tool to communicate the whole fraternity of the teachers. We are going to communicate to the students through the WhatsApp. We are going to share the information through the WhatsApp. So why can't we use this as one of the tools for training our students? Why can't you have develop a collaborative course assignments to the millennials so that it makes more and more meaningful and more impressive for the teaching the students? Of course, nowadays we are talking about more and more about the smart classrooms where every table should have the tablet or the smartphones or anything else, and where they're going to sit and learn and all those things. But friends, when you're seeing this empty class, don't believe that your class will be empty like this. Students will be around the teachers. Students will be around a good teacher, and good teacher will be recognized. Provided we are going to retool ourselves, repurpose ourselves, adopt some technology, change ourselves, then the sky is the limit to understand or to adopt the technology for the effective teaching. But what are the principles or the ground pedagogy and principle effective learnings? There are four E's are there. One is engaging interest, encoding important information, elaborating meaning the new learned material, and evaluating procedures, progress. So these are four principles of effective learning in many of the concepts. To adopt these four the concepts into the even the using the technology or anything else, we can make it. They expect the information to be presented in a digestible morsels and not lengthy expositions, not very long sentences, long things. we can be more effectively grab their attention by using engaging but very brief lecture starters. A 60 minutes class can be divided into four to engaging in interest is like start with the personal examples, personal experiences, followed by demonstrations, including some quiz, puzzles, question answer sessions, rope in some short movies, rope in some video clips. Then you can see how the 60 minutes you are going to engage the students from right from 1 minute to the end of the 60th minute. The days you have gone, right from if I'm starting class at 3 o'clock, keep on writing, keep on writing, keep on writing. I'm sure the students will be chatting, chatting, chatting. There'll be huge disconnect with the students as well as the teachers. Continuing this, engaging with the interest, we can apply the rule of 10 or sometimes 12 or sometimes 12 or some 10 minutes, sometimes 12 minutes or perhaps 15 minutes. What is this concept of the rule of 10? That is, we can shift from lecture to discussion, discussion to video clip demonstration to back again during the class experience. Precisely all these four principles have been used in this flipped classroom. That's what I'm going to start a little later. The second component during the 60 minutes of classes, we should have to incur the important information. Information requires more time and effort than casual reading. It's not like I'm going to read a newspaper, but it makes time spent studying more and more effective, productive, and rewarding. That's very, very important because you should have to create a lot of curiosity and interest in the students to make it more and more. And the last two were elaborating meaning and evaluating progress. So reaching and teaching millennial students challenges us to adopt more methods to teaching learning needs of the students today. We should put our leg in the shoes of students and understand what you want from a class. How should I teach the class? How should I engage yourself? Instead of telling, no, my teacher has taught like this, I am the way how I am going to teach the classes. No, the days are gone. You'll be outdated teacher. By doing so that, you should have to interact more with our students and lecturing less. We should have to speak less, interact more. We can create more and more dynamic learning environment to help our students become more effective learners. So these are the four effective E's are there where you should have to adopt. And other way is also in didactic lecture, so we should have to adopt it. When you use the technology also, you are supposed to adopt it so that it becomes more and more effective learning, qualitative learning, and bringing the millennials to make them understanding and make them to sit in the class or make them to use the classes and make it more effective learning. Right from generation X, Y, Z and millennials, why are we supposed to do it? What are the challenges? Keeping all this in the mind, the thing is that we should have to flip the classroom. What does it mean? To reach successes, we must not be able to move outside of our comfort zone. And probably, flipped classroom may not be the fix, but one of the many methods that are used to increase an active learning environment. At the end of my talk, I'll be sharing my experiment and my experience with the students. But teachers have got their own ways and methods as they can adopt either one of the method. And one of the method, what we have taken for the day today is that to have talk about the flipped classrooms. Now you may be thinking that, right, sir, we understood what is flipped. We understood what are the generations. We appreciate we are the millennium generation we are talking. Okay, we are understanding that they have got short span of the listening, patience nahi hai, sab kuch ho gaya, then what are supposed to do it? One of the technologies that we are going to use it, that using the classroom. Now, how to use this classroom? How to flip it? Here the flipping is sorry, I think it was muted. What is typically given as a homework is done in a class with the assistance of a teacher. Exactly vice versa. That's what we did during pandemic. All the lectures were given through the videos, through GoToMeeting, through Zoom. We made a lot of efforts to reach our students during the pandemic. Even now also we are doing certain classes online. But how to flip this? That is a challenge. So flipping is typically present in the class, that is lectures, content background, knowledge, or real life experiences by live teacher. Student receives at a home via podcast, through YouTube, through videos, through lectures. Everything we are going to give them in the home. That's what we have done all the time now. When the students come back to the classes, now we should have to engage them in the tutorials. Now we should engage them into the group discussions, what we are taught, because already they studied, they read everything. When they come back to the classes, we should have to engage them. I'll tell the advantages of this flipped classrooms. So the flipped classroom is not just online videos. Obviously, it is not replacing teachers with videos. Never, never it happens. If you Google it out, videos and flipped classroom, we got hundreds of flipped classroom lectures. But still, we need somebody to read, somebody to understand, then explain to the people whom we are targeting the population. So there's no replacement of the teachers. It's not just an online classes. It's not like students working without any structures. It's not like students working in isolations. And it's not like students spending entire class in the class online. It's not all those things. Then what is it? It means that flipped classroom is nothing but it means to increase teachers' contact time. In 60 minutes, how much I am accessible to the students. In 60 minutes, how much I am communicable to the students. In 60 minutes of one class, how much I am interactive with the students. That is about the flipped classroom. Here we are going to create an environment to increase student responsibilities rather than the teacher's responsibilities. We should emphasize the student, look, you have taken admission to earn the knowledge. The days are gone saying that I'm going to join here the college to get a degree. No. If you've got experience teaching the now new the B-Farm, specifically the foundry students, you experience, teachers experience that demand now, students demands. But the flipped classroom is blending of direct instructions and constructivist learning. It is a blending of both. Flipped classroom is nothing but classes where all students are engaged, not the first row students or middle row students or some pocket of the students. No, we are going to engage every student by doing these sessions. A flipped classroom is a class where absent students won't fall behind. We're happy that you are all NAC accredited colleges and NBA accredited colleges, and where they have got a lot of significance in what you call slow learners and fast learners. We should take everybody together in the class and see that at the end of the day, they graduate with a certain knowledge, certain skills. By using this blended learning of the technology and the flipped classroom, we can't leave the students far behind, because all the materials are given previous day. The students will read, they learn, they come back to the next day classes, and we have a lot of interactions with that things. And flipped classroom is nothing but a class where all students are engaged in their learning, not by hearting, not just writing for the examinations. This is a classical model of the flipped classroom. It has got a four quadrants, right? One is the experience quadrant. Then what happens is, so what? And now what? So these are the four quadrants are there. And these two are learner generated, right? These two are educator suggested, right? These are four quadrants are there. So educator suggested means what happens is in that classroom, what teachers can do it. He can adopt a lot of games, simulations, and interactiveness. Develop more and more experiments. Develop more and more community projects. I'm sure all teachers will agree with me saying that whenever there is an NSS activity, the students are in forefront. They love doing community projects. Put some lot of arts and activities. These are all educator suggested activities as an experience. Students will get a lot of experience by doing these things. Next, so what to do for to achieve all those things? Develop a video lectures. I'm sure all teachers have done all these things by this time. Because of pandemic, no students are in the class. We have all done these video lectures. We all prepared video and audio lectures, right? Nowadays, many of the institutions, they are starting their content-rich websites. Video lecturing systems, video capturing systems are there. Student learning management systems are there. So all these things are there available, what we call as, you know, what is going to happen. Online class chats are there. So basically, this is a concept exploration. What happens is if you connect experience with the students. Next, take this to the next quadrant effectively. Okay, we are done with this, all those things. So what happens is, so here we should have the blogging, reflective video, audiovisual reflection. We call it and it tests. We all do tests very popularly, internal assessment. But we forget what is called as a reflection learning. What is a reflective learning? It is precisely saying that learner is going to reflect upon what he has said or not, whether he's understood or not. He's going to see the video, listen the lectures, listen the audios. Is he going to reflect upon that? What is reflective means what? Whatever we have seen, whatever we've been proposed, is it be transcribed? Is it to be able to transfer? So after experience, so what happened? So what? Now what we do it? Now create a personalized project presentation. This is what we are going to blend it right from this to this. We are going to blend it, having that create personalized project presentations then that includes demonstrations and applications. For example, if I'm teaching a pharmacology of diabetic foot ulcer, I should able to demonstrate that I'm going to tell that why I'm teaching these applications. Getting experiential engagement. Then having the concept exploration and meaning making. If you clump all those things, then it becomes as the, what we call it as an, flipped classroom, effective classroom, or it becomes a blending of the technology and all those things. Probably many people might have laughed if this lecture would have been done before the pandemic. And during the pandemic, I'm sure everybody appreciates saying that, yeah, this is the correct way of doing the students is where you're going to, when the students come back to the campus, when the students come back to the campus, we should have to engage them in this because already we've taken the class. Now, how are we going to go ahead with those things? The simple method is that adopt all those things and then it becomes as the meaning of the flipped classrooms. Means what? The flipped classroom speaks the language of the today's students. Short span of listening, they are well versed in the technology, they are good in technology. Nowadays helps the busy students. Students may be busy with some other activities. We can group them as an advanced learners. It helps for struggling students, right? It may help for the struggling students. Struggling students, who are those? They are the slow learners. And it helps the students to abilities to excel. That is the whole fund of all the any teachers are going to do it. Important is that allow the students to pause and rewind their teachers. For example, if I complete the class in my 3 to 4 hours, now my lecture, I'm seeing 127 people are attending this session. They may be busy with something else. It's not a crime. They might have logged in. They may be busy with something else. We should accept it. What is the advantage? The logged in faculties can again go back and visit my lecture. Wherever is left, he can listen, he can understand, he can pause, he can wind, he can rewind. So all these advantages is there so that it goods for the slow learner as well as the advanced learner. By adopting all those things, when you get back, adopting all those things, the students, when the students will come right? They increase the students teachers interactions. I still remember my teacher used to tell that before coming classes, you should read and come. You should have to read and come to the classes. Nowadays, instead of reading, they should listen to us and come back. Use our videos, use our lectures, read and come to the class. When they come in the class, natural students have got a lot of questions to be asked. It becomes more and more interactions. We can have the debate. We can have interactive session. We can have group discussions. Then it becomes more and more interesting for the students. Of course, I may not agree with this last sentence of my slide. It educates not only students, but parents and other siblings. I don't know to what extent this professional courses may help. It may be good with some fine arts or anything else. Right? Now, why should we not change if? Because you think it is a cutting edge, or because it is easier, or just because everyone doing it, or because it exempts us from being a good teacher. You should select what is the risk benefit, pros and cons, and try to blend the technology and the education. And at the end of the day, the whole philosophy or principle of a teacher is that to be an effective teacher. Convert our teaching into effective learning. Convert our teaching into effective knowledge base to the students. To do that, there was a popular book was published long back where the person said that from sage on the stage to the guide on the side. We are no more sage on the stage. We are no more teachers, rishiminis. We are not a spiritual leader standing on the stage. We should have to guide on the side. We should have to come to the student, next to the student, sit with the student, make it more and more interesting to the students. So traditionally what we had, lectures in the class, homework activities in the home. Flipping is exactly different. So lectures in the home, after office hours, in the night, in the morning, whatever the convenience are there, and activities in the class. And this is more and more precise for an education like pharmacy. If I'm teaching the tablet punching or anything else, give a lecture. They can wind, rewind, understand, come back to the next day. Next day, instead of taking their didactic lectures, engage them showing the punches, dies, showing real punching, discussing your experience, then students will get involved, engrossed in your lectures. They never sleep, they never chat. Believe me, the class will be full. Right? So just to summarize my talk, so that I have got room for question answer sessions and all those things. So before going to this, precisely what I would like to share here is that when you are going to flip the classroom, it's nothing but it's a blend of technology as well as the classes where you're going to do this. A simple question I would like to ask for all people who are religiously attending my session, that too at the post-lunch in the afternoon. Friends, for whom are we calling as a professor? Introspect yourself. A professor is called as a professing. So what is professing? Professing nothing but sharing your experience. That's the reason earlier earlier universities have got then a tutor, lecturer, assistant professor and professor. Now UGC has taken out lecturer. They say that directly from assistant professor, associate professor and a professor. Assuming that a degree teacher, a college level teacher should have enough experience to teach the classes. And if you've got experience, not teaching the classes, experience in the subject, knowledge in the subject, what you are going to correlate for the applications. Basically, I teach the PharmD students, right? If I am teaching a diabetic foot ulcer, giving a lame example again, in classes, if I start my class saying that yesterday I saw the patient of 65-year-old having uncontrolled diabetes and having this uncontrolled diabetes, non-healing diabetic foot ulcer, treated with this, then you see the understand the glamour on the face of the students. They eagerly they listen because that is not there in the textbooks. That's the experience I'm going to share. If you're teaching pharmaceutics, as I said, give lectures, show practicals. Share your experience if you have worked in the industries. Share your experience if you have seen the industrial the punching machines. If not, why can't we go and see? Why can't we go and gather the experience? To all my fellow colleagues, if I ask, do you have experience? Yes, I got teaching experience. Friends, it has gone that time. Nobody wants to ask your teaching experience. They want to ask the knowledge in the subjects, application of the knowledge in the subjects. Right? So here, just to summarize, the Bloom's flipped learning is very precisely, it is a reverse of this pyramid. Traditionally, what are we doing in the home, right, are done in the classroom. And whatever you should do here in this, it is done in the classroom. For example, remembering, understanding, applying the knowledge, analyzing, evaluating, and creating. Earlier, all this time, they used to do everything in the home. But unfortunately, sitting in the home, they can't be creative thinker. Traditionally, we used to all make them to sit and bahar, read, make them to understand. But once you flip the classroom, right? Flip the classroom, in the class you are going to create, you are going to evaluate, you are going to analyze, you are going to apply. And in the home, they are going to understand, they are going to remember. So this is the beauty. You can make a small experiment. It may become like a fancy story. Friends, believe me, we have tried this. It is working very good. We call it as a blended learning. Right now we are doing the blended classes. Half of the class, we do with blended learning. Then you may be saying, sir, itna karne ke baad classroom mein kaun baithega? Right? Don't worry. It doesn't happen like this. Right? So what are you supposed to do during the classrooms? Engage them in debates. Right? Debate is a beautiful tool. This is a tool I used to try in all my quality improvement program, AICT-funded quality improvement program. KL is one of the center. Whenever we have got a QIP program in my department, I used to engage a debate of a teacher. So lively, shouting, cheering, sharing their experience. At the end of the day, happy learning. Right? During the classes, allow them to practice. Maybe pilot scale, maybe model, but allow them to practice. During the class, conduct a lot of experiments. Obviously, we do that. And let them imitate. They let them repeat. Let them understand what purposes we are doing it. This is all they can do in the during the classroom. Then allow them to create so that they can create something new, producing work on an individual or as a group. And they can become a meta learners, self-reflective learners, where the learners start thinking about their own learning. That's what we call as a self-reflection, very important, and self-analysis. If you could bring in this new millennials, then you can be rated as the best teacher, or you can be rated as the one of the good teacher. Right? So then what are the pre-class activities? Pre-class activities are they're going to receive. They are going to explore. Right? They're going to receive and they're going to explore. Right? Before the class are concerned, they're going to receive and they're going to explore the things. So what are the sources can be used for dissemination of your knowledge? You can use YouTube, you can use anything else. They are called as a micro degrees from Khan Academy, right? TED Talks, journalism, future learning, podcast, video learning, all those things can be grouped into receiving the materials to the students. Some of the tips before I wind, start small, inform your students, home learning, ensure you incorporate an activity following reading, plan your classes time to optimize the learning environment. Home learning is important to build and extending learning further. Right? So these are the things what I would like to share with you to why are we using the technology, why we should blend it, why we should merge mixing the technology along with the thing what are we doing it. With this, we did a small exercise, a small experiment, what we call it as a PharmD colloquium. This is a third. We have proposed it from April 9th and 10th. If somebody can read it, platform created exclusive more for a student-oriented activities and there are no didactic lectures. Is it not interesting? We are conducting a two-day PharmD colloquium and I say there are no didactic lectures. Then what I'm going to do there? Precisely, we are going to use a technology. We are going to blend the technology, understand the psychology of the psyche of the students or the participants. We know many of the conferences are there. Only the speaker will be shouting on the dais. Nobody will be sitting in the hall. Have you thought about those things? How can we bring them into the mainstreams? So what we did it for all the PharmD students is we had the poster presentations. When I say the poster presentations, it is not a scientific poster presentation. I said it is a purely copy paste because they're all expert. Chalo, theek hai, ek theme de do. You get it from Google, wherever is there. Your hypothetical imagination, for example, immunization as the pharmacist-led immunization across the world. Ask them to make a poster. They'll go research what is happening in Europe, what is happening in Middle East, what is happening in Australia, what is happening in New Zealand. They do a lot of search. Make a poster, come and present. What is the end of the day? They learned saying that what is the role of pharmacist immunization. For a fast learners, ask them to present. Have the street plays. Another thing, what we experimented was a storytelling. Tell them to narrate their professional experiences. By doing this, we develop the stage courage. They get away with the stage fear. They think they are a main part of the whole understanding. Every student has got a smartphone. Why can't they use that smartphone as an advantage to make them a short movies? Then, Subsequently, we had an interactive panel discussion and we call it as a Mann Ki Baat. In this Mann Ki Baat, what we did is we called all the success people to share the success stories. In the success stories, again, they never gave the lectures. Right? They never gave the lectures. We started asking their journey from the right from B-Pharm, from M-Pharm, what are they doing? What problem they struggle to get these jobs? Call alumni, interact with them. That becomes more and more reflective learning. This is what precisely we did an experiment two times before pandemic. This time also doing, believe me, students thoroughly enjoyed. Should have been done like third PharmD workshop, PharmD conference, registration, all those things, but there'll be nobody in the class. But when I started doing this experiment, believe me, all class was full. Entire hall was full. So this is what small experiment we did it, saying that how to blend the class, how to use a flip, how to use a technology, how to understand millennial psychology. So all those things we did, we are able to success. Before formally conclude with my thanks, I thank P.D. Chaudhary sir, Chopde sir, and all the organizers made an elaborative efforts to conduct this very marathonous sessions, well-planned, meticulously planned, and well done. And thank all the participants for patiently listening throughout my session. Should you have any questions, I'm happy to take the questions. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful session. Now the session is open for question and answer. If anybody wants to ask question, kindly DM in chat box. Okay. Thank you, sir. I would like to highlight few points of the session. So we learn about the flipped classroom and its need for today's generation. We also learn about the three generations X, Y, and Z, and the students or the people or means the persons who are born in 1990s are called as also millennials, means the X generation, XZ generation. So but now who are born in 2000s, so can we call them millennials, sir?
I think it can be done, nothing wrong in that, right? As a creative teacher. Yeah, I agree.
Okay. So the third point, we also learned about how students are surrounded by technology and how we can use technology to reach them inside and outside of the class. And also the principle of effective teaching with four E's: engaging, encoding, elaborating, and evaluating. Also, we learn about the videos and audio lectures and also the help of YouTube. It was a wonderful session, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir, thank you for sharing your knowledge, ideas, and your valuable time with us. Now, I kindly request you to accept a virtual bouquet and certificate on behalf of Principal Dr. P.D. Chaudhary, sir, and Coordinator Dr. V. Chopra and team. I take this opportunity to thank you, sir, and all participants for attending session and cooperating with us. Our next session